Hi guys, Omar is here. Today we're running both Windows 11 and Windows 2000 on the same 10th Gen Core i5 system. The Socket 1200 platform came out in 2020 and it's fully supported by Windows 11. But Windows 2000 was never meant to run on hardware like this. We're talking about a 20-year gap. But what if I told you we can not only install Windows 2000, but actually get full support for NVMe, USB 3, ACPI, HD audio, and more. So let's get started. The whole build came together for around $250, thanks to a cheap new motherboard and a mix of freebies, leftovers, and second-hand parts. Some of this stuff is nearly 10 years old, and most of the budget was saved for grabbing a halfway decent GPU. It all started when a friend got his hands on a free 10th Gen Core i5. Then he called me asking if I had a cooler. I said, yeah, I should have one. Not a big deal, really. Socket 1200 uses the same mounting holes as the previous Intel generations. Next thing I know, he shows up with a pile of parts and I'm building a PC using a case from the AM3 Plus era and a power supply that says it can deliver 650 watts. Probably. Or maybe not. Anyway, the power draw isn't crazy with this build, so honestly, it's good enough if it just works. So what exactly do we have here? A brand new Gigabyte H410 V2 motherboard for $60. It's not the best out there, but it's better than it sounds. It actually comes with the more capable H470 chipset. No mistake, it's clearly stated on the box. The H470 offers more PCIe lanes, though this motherboard doesn't take full advantage of them. The good part, it does have 2PS2 ports, which really helps when testing classic operating systems. Now the CPU, it's an Intel i5-10505. This is an OEM chip with just 100 MHz bump on the base clock over the regular 10500 model. This go for around $70 used today, so we're looking at a $130 combo with something like the cheapest compatible motherboard. For around $60 more, we could get a similar setup with a 10-core 13th-gen i5, which definitely gives you something to think about. But this i5 was completely free, so I think we can't complain about the performance per dollar ratio. The GPU is a 2060 Super with 8GB of RAM. The Super model has a 256 memory bus, which helps it perform close to the RTX 3060 in some cases. So the PC was all set for its new owner, but before handing it over, it's time to shift gears into retro mode. The original plan was to test several versions of Windows. Classic versions to see how they perform on this i5 10th gen setup, especially since the Socket 1200 platform hasn't got much screen time on this channel. Now, there is a bit of bad news. Windows 98 doesn't play nice with the onboard SATA on this motherboard. But don't worry, we've got something epic to make up for it. One of my awesome and active subscribers asked me to check a custom Windows 2000 build with a lot of backport stuff inside. Let's just say there are a lot of CPUs are now showing up, and that's only the beginning, so stay tuned because this Windows 2000 setup is something special. But first, let's see how the original or vanilla Windows 2K handles this build. So I started with one of my usual installs. It booted up just fine, no issues, thanks to the ACPI support provided by the UNIATA drivers, which were already installed. For the GPU, I went with a Quadro FX 4500, planning to test it in Windows NT4 later on, but I didn't get that far. By the way, this Quadro was launched around mid-2005, but in Windows 2K, though, we can go as far as the GTX 400 series, since the last official NVIDIA driver for Windows 2K was released in 2010. Another thing that works well with Windows 2000 is multiprocessor support through the MPS standard. It runs right out of the box, no patches, no workarounds, if the motherboard's BIOS still includes support for it. Good news on Intel motherboards, up to socket 1700 MPS is still available. The installation I started though was actually running in standard PC mode, which limits the system to single CPU operation. But here's a little trick, this can be easily changed from the control panel, where we can switch the computer type to MPS multiprocessor PC, and after the next restart two CPUs appeared. Not bad when running on a modern motherboard using a standard that's been around since 1995. On older motherboards, we can select ACPI instead, which is better than FPS. When it works, which isn't the case with the newer setups, but wait, things got even more interesting. As I mentioned earlier, one of my subscribers, let's call him AG, asked me to check out a custom Windows 2000 build he created using SysPrep, which is short for System Preparation Tool. The idea behind SysPrep is to create a pre-configured Windows installation with drivers, networking settings, and so on, ready for deployment across multiple machines, because no sysadmin wants to manually install Windows 2000 on every single computer in the building. AG also started a project called Universal NT Installer, which was released just a week ago. The idea is to quickly install any version of Windows NT up to XP by booting from a USB stick running Linux. From there, we can deploy any supported OS to the partition of our choice. I like to mention that my contribution to this project was promoting the UNIATA drivers in previous Windows NT videos, and now those very same drivers are used by the Universal NT Installer. This is especially crucial for running Windows NT 3.5X and NT 4.0, where we have no other alternatives if we want to boot from the onboard setup ports using the AACI protocol. Now back to the Windows 2000 build that AG shared with me. It includes a lot of backported drivers, but he didn't create the original ISO himself, so details are somewhat limited. I wish I had more information to properly credit all the people who made this possible. By the way, there is a Windows 2000 Discord server. I think I'll find most of my answers there and come back with more details in a future episode. Anyway, I suspect the ISO includes a patch ACPI sys originally meant for XP and later adapted for Windows 2K. I talk a lot about ACPI in my previous video on XP x64, check it out if you want more info. Now here is what I know for sure. ACPI support is working, the system detects all the logical CPUs, 12 in this case, and power-related functions like soft shutdown work correctly. Restart though has some issues. Next we have NVMe support. This is pretty impressive for Windows 2000. I tested the NVMe driver with a Samsung PM981 PCIe Gen 3 NVMe SSD, and it works surprisingly well. This drive can deliver up to 3.5 gigabytes per second, which is about the maximum we would expect from a high-end PCIe Gen 3 SSD, and we are getting pretty close. I also tested NVMe performance with Windows XP on this exact setup using the same NVMe SSD, and Windows XP gives us the maximum performance possible, but still the numbers we are getting on Windows 2000 are pretty crazy. And yes, Windows XP Service Pack 3, which is the x86 version, works perfectly fine on this setup. I wouldn't expect otherwise. Finally, the most surprising part, or maybe not, was to find generic USB 3 support in this build. Some early USB 3 chipsets can work with Windows 2000, but seeing native USB 3 support was a huge surprise. I mean, this is massive. If you ask me, getting USB 3 support is even more complicated than NVMe. For now, there is no support for the USB protocol from USB attached SCSI. This means many USB 3 external drives and SSD enclosures that rely on USB will be detected, but we won't be able to actually use them. So we're limited to devices that use the good old USB mass storage protocol. Now back to things that are working. The onboard Realtek HD audio works using official drivers. But if the onboard audio won't work, we can use HDMI audio. Just be careful if we try to install the NVIDIA HDMI audio driver on an unpatched version of Windows 2000, it will brick our system. That's because the driver expects a newer version of the NTOS kernel. It's one of those cases where a driver labeled 2K/XP compatible, it's really XP only, unless, like in our case, we're running Windows 2000 with a patched kernel. Another thing that works, of course, is the onboard Realtek Gigabit Ethernet chip. This was easy to install. There are some modernish browsers like MyPal that work with Windows 2000 or Pal Moon, but I didn't dig too much into this area though. This version uses a kernel extender, but it's not the same as the extended kernel made by the user Blackwing Cat. With Blackwing Cat's extended kernel, we can run a lot of newer programs that would require Windows XP. However, I'm concerned that installing it might break compatibility with some of these drivers. Otherwise, I think it would have been included in this build already. I had this socket 1200 set up for just one day, so I didn't have time to do much more testing, but while putting this video together I got curious, could we actually use the NVMe SSD as the boot drive? So basically I copied the installation from the SATA drive to the NVMe SSD using an external enclosure, then I plug it into an Intel 6th gen motherboard via a PCIe to NVMe adapter. And it worked. Yes, we can boot Windows 2000 from NVMe. And since this LGA 1151 board is quite similar to socket 1200, all the onboard components like USB, LAN, ACPI, and audio worked right out of the box. Well, I guess that's it for today. If you want the files used in this video, you can download them for free from my Patreon page. Also, you might want to check the Universal NT installer. Thanks for watching and stay tuned for more. Omores out.